If you have the tracking generator option installed on your HSA, then by adding the CAT option, you'll be able to measure antenna return loss and VSWR, single port cable attenuation, and distance to fault on cables, looking for cable breaks or damaged cables. These are the measurements we need to make to confirm that an antenna and cable are working according to specification. They're not damaged and with no connector problems. The CAT option is available on the N9342C, the 7 GHz model, and the great advantage of this option is that the directional bridge is built in, greatly simplifying the measurement setup. Let's start by measuring the return loss and VSWR of this Wi-Fi antenna I have here. First, we'll press the green preset button to put the instrument back to its factory default state and clear any strange settings that a previous operator may have used. And then press mode, cable and antenna test. And you can see here the three measurements. We can make a reflection measurement, that's return loss or VSWR, a one port cable loss measurement, and distance to fault. We'll start with the reflection measurement of this Wi-Fi antenna. So I'll press frequency and enter a start frequency of 5 GHz and a stop frequency of 6 GHz. And next we need to do a calibration. You'll see here there are two cal types. We can either select full, which will calibrate the entire frequency range of the instrument, which means we can connect any antenna, change frequency, and not have to recalibrate every time. But in this instance, we know that this antenna operates around 5.5 GHz. So I'm going to select the cal type of selected, and this will just calibrate over the frequency range of interest. So we press calibrate and follow the on-screen instructions. We connect an open and press enter. And we connect a short and press enter. And we connect a load and press enter. And now the instrument is calibrated between 5 and 6 GHz. So I'll disconnect the standard and connect the antenna. So with the antenna connected, you can see now we're sweeping from 5 GHz to 6 GHz on the x-axis, and we're measuring return loss on the y-axis in dB. 0 dB is the top line of the graticule, and you can see here that there's a marker. Marker 2 is automatically searching for the deepest valley on the trace, and you can see that the resonant frequency of this antenna is at about 5.3 GHz. The return loss is about 24 dB, and the VSWR at that frequency is about 1.1 to 1. We can move these markers manually if we wish, or add more markers by pressing the marker button. I could turn on marker 3, and I can move that with the knob. Also, if I press the mesh button, instead of displaying return loss, we can measure and display VSWR. So the x-axis is still showing frequency from 5 to 6 GHz, but the y-axis is now displaying VSWR. And if we prefer, we can measure reflection coefficient. I'll go back to return loss for now. One more thing, if the antenna you're sweeping is installed on a mast at a shared transmitter site where other transmitters are active, those transmissions can cause interference spikes on the return loss trace. But pressing the IIM button on the HSA automatically rejects these interfering signals and removes them from the trace. A very useful feature. If you can access both ends of a cable, for example, when it's still on its cable reel when new, then you don't need to use this feature, as the HSA's tracking generator can be used to make a standard two-port measurement of insertion loss. But if your cable is already installed on a mast, then this feature is extremely useful, as it allows us to measure the cable's attenuation from just one end of the cable. So all I need to do is connect my cable to the HSA, and because we want to test this cable over the same frequency range that we tested the antenna in the previous measurement, I don't need to perform another calibration. It says the instrument is already calibrated between 5 and 6 GHz. All I have to do is press the mesh key and select one port cable loss. So the x-axis is again still showing frequency, sweeping between 5 and 6 gigahertz, but the y-axis is now giving us a measurement of cable attenuation in dB across that frequency range. We can press the marker button and select any of the 6 markers. So here, marker 1, you can see at 5.1 gigahertz, the cable has an attenuation of 5.8 dB. And at the bottom of the screen, it tells us the average cable loss across the frequency range of 5 to 6 gigahertz. And currently, the average cable loss is about 6.4 dB. Now let's make a distance to fault measurement of the same cable. With this, we can identify the physical distance to cable breaks, cable damage, damaged connectors, water ingress, and the like. So let's press the instrument preset button, mode, select cable and antenna test, and this time I'm going to select the measurement of distance to fault. The y-axis still shows return loss in dB, but the x-axis now shows distance to fault in meters, or in feet if you prefer. We need to tell the instrument approximately how long the cable is. This will optimize the measurement and avoid unnecessarily testing beyond the end of the cable. If you're new to making distance to fault measurements and are not familiar with Fourier transforms, be aware that the frequency span you're sweeping directly influences the maximum distance you can measure, and also how accurately you can resolve the distance to faults. In general, a wider frequency span will give you finer resolution, but will limit the length of the cable you can measure. Reducing the span, on the other hand, will allow us to test longer cables, but with less resolution. And this is true of all distance to fault measuring instruments, not just the Agilent HSA. And if you've performed distance to fault measurements before, you'll know that we need to select the correct cable type to ensure that the distance and return loss scales are accurate. So we press the More button, press Cable Specification. We can select the frequency at which the cable specifications were measured, in this case 1 GHz. And if I press Select Cable, we can scroll down through a very long list of all the most common commercially available RF cables. In this case, I'm going to select RG214. And press Select. But if your cable wasn't in that list, you can easily enter your own values of cable attenuation and velocity factor directly from the cable manufacturer's datasheet. Now, I know this cable is less than 15 meters long, so I'll set the stop distance to 16 meters. Next, we need to perform a calibration like we did previously. So I'll press Frequency and Calibrate. And we just follow the instructions. So I'll connect the open and press Enter. We connect the short and press Enter. And we connect the load and press Enter. So the instrument's now calibrated. So all I have to do now is connect my cable and we're measuring distance to fault. You can see here at 0 meters, there's a small peak here on the trace, which is the good match. It's about a 30 dB return loss, a good match between the type N port on the HSA and this type N connector on the cable. So that's no problem. But here you'll see, well, there's the end of the cable here at marker 1, saying it's 14.75 meters long, as I expected. Very, very large return loss or reflection there, because the end of the cable is not terminated. It's an open circuit, so 100% reflection, or close to. But here you can see 2 very clear faults in the cable. Now, I know those faults are there because I made up this cable from, in fact, 3 lengths of cable and used some poor quality adapters to simulate some cable faults. So let's press marker and turn on marker 2. And you can see that discontinuity there is at 11.9 meters and is a fairly poor return loss of about 15 dB. And I'll turn on marker 3. And let's just line that up with the other discontinuity there. That cable break there, or cable fault, is at 9.04 meters from this point here. So in just a few short steps, we've managed to test the cable, and it, generally speaking, the cable is pretty good apart from 2 significant faults at 9 meters and about 11 meters along the cable. And there's one more really nice feature of the distance default measurement on the HSA. You'll see here there's a button called frequency domain. If I turn that on, now the screen is split into two displays. The top half is still showing us return loss versus distance, the same distance default measurement we were making just now, but now the lower half of the screen is showing us return loss versus frequency. So we can make a normal return loss measurement at the same time as making a distance default measurement. And of course, we can save all of these instrument setups and measurement results into the internal memory or directly to a USB memory stick for emailing to a client or documenting in a report. For further information on the Agilent HSA, please visit the website shown below or contact your local representative.